Yeah, please, sir.
I have great pleasure in introducing first Professor Urmila Kulkarni Kale of Savitribai Phule Pune University. She has worked very extensively on viral bioinformatics. The major research goals are to study evolution of viruses, emergence of subtypes, and correlation of genotype with phenotype using bioinformatics, immunoinformatics, comparative genomics, phyloinformatics approaches. She designed and developed a lot of databases, algorithms, and servers for archival analysis and interpretation of data in the area of bioinformatics and biology. She has received several coveted awards and have a couple of translation bilateral grants to her credit as a project investigator. She has over 70 publications. The other co-speaker in the workshop today is Sunita Manjari. She's a joint director and she's an expert in bioinformatics, and she's working for Center for Development of Advanced Computing for over 2 decades. She has a very strong inclination for microbial bioinformatics and developed several tools and methods. She was part of development of Anvaya, where she co-led the project for CDAC. She is currently in her final year PhD working with Dr. Urmila Kulkarni Kale. I know both of them from Pune University days from 1987, when Urmila was a PhD student. And I also have taught Sunita in Bioinformatics Center at Pune University. I am very pleased to request them to talk today on viral bioinformatics. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jayaramanan. Thank you, Prash. Are my slides visible?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Okay. So maybe we can start. Good evening, one and all. And indeed, it is a pleasure to be part of this interesting workshop series which BioClues has launched. I have been associated with BioClues for a few years now, and it's impressed with the way in which Professor Jayaraman, Dr. Prash, and many others have been working very hard to take bioinformatics in India forward, and very pleased to be associated with the BioClues in general and with this particular workshop in particular. A small sort of correction that I don't have a number of publication which Professor Jayaraman mentioned, but maybe it's a good number to wish for. So thank you, Jayaraman sir, for that generous introduction as well. So, Manjari and myself have been planning this this activity for 2 days, and then Manjari told me that some of you are medical graduates, so the participants' background is like some of you are medical graduates, some are from the biology stream, and various other walks of life with different varied length of experience in the field. So we have taken a few of these factors into account while planning the workshop, but please feel free to stop me or Sunita at any point of time if you think that you need some sort of explanation before we go ahead. So there is no hard and fast rule that we have to complete certain part of the agenda. I'll put my phone on silent mode. All right. So this is the first session on virus bioinformatics, and I plan to provide you with the perspective on virus evolution. So basically, we are going to look at some of the molecular phylogeny methods and typing of viruses in this particular session. It's a wonderful world of viruses. Viruses are omnipresent. They are everywhere. You have phages that infect microbes. You have animal viruses like foot and mouth disease virus, you have HIV and SARS-CoV that infect human, in addition to many, many others. And then there are set of viruses that infect plants. So you have, viruses invading and infecting almost all life forms. What makes them very interesting to study is that they come in different sizes and shapes. Okay, there's a large variety in terms of shape and size of viruses. They usually have very, very large population sizes. So you will have several hundred thousand isolates of every single virus that circulates in some or the other part of the world. Viruses have relatively very, very simple genome organization. Their genomic structures are relatively simple, except for some giant viruses like mimiviruses, which have, relatively complex genomic organization. What is most important for us is that you have availability of genomic data. And these genomes are usually, sequenced by virologists or by, microbiologists, in individual labs. There are no fancy consortia as far as genome sequencing of viruses is concerned. You have large number of these viruses sequence deposited in the database. So they're easily accessible, available for anyone to sort of computationally explore them in terms of their biology and many other aspects. So availability of genomic data is one very, very important and very interesting feature of viruses. Viruses can be very bad, and we have had a very tough 1.5 year with SARS-CoV-2. It emerged in Wuhan and then spread all across the world. And I don't have to emphasize the effect coronavirus pandemic have had on all of us, whether it is personal life, professional life. It has impacted in more than many ways, from education to economy. There are a lot of challenges. But what became very, very apparent in coronavirus pandemic, science became central, and we'll talk about coronavirus tomorrow as a case study. But what has been said that nothing in biology makes sense except in the light of evolution. So, in the light of evolution, you can put things in perspective. You can understand, behavior of organisms, including viruses. And let us see then what are the different methods that we have in order to study evolution. And before we really get into the methods to study evolution of viruses, let us quickly have a look at that this phylogenomics, that is carrying out phylogenetic studies using genomes or typing of viruses, what are the application areas? So, usually this proves to be a starting point for characterization of virus isolates. Okay, you need to sort of, if you want to classify the viruses, you want to diagnose, what kind of viruses are circulating in the population. You want to perform epidemiological studies. You want to design drugs. You want to design diagnostics. You want to design vaccine. Your analysis of data would invariably begin with phylogenetic analysis. And that's the reason we thought that we would have 101 for virus bioinformatics with phylogeny and systematics. Now, when it comes to computational approaches for typing classification of viruses, WHO, then CDC, TDR, and ICTV, these are the main organizations which look after typing of viruses. So ICTV is International Committee on Taxonomy of Viruses. And they have different study groups, and they sort of guide us with respect to principles for typing of various viruses or classification of various viruses, as you all probably aware of, but just to sort of touch upon the base, viruses have two types of genomes. You have DNA viruses, viruses that have DNA as genome, and RNA viruses, which have RNA as genome. RNA viruses can be double or single-stranded. So also DNA viruses can be double or single-stranded. And then there is further further attribute like positive sense and negative sense RNA viruses and so on and so forth. So this broad classification, you know, if you go down the hierarchy, then you have several virus families, subfamily, genera, and then individual organism or individual species. But that individual species in itself is further divided into genotypes and serotypes. And you know, members that belong to different serotypes or genotypes have very, very characteristic phenotypic features. And that is why it becomes essential to have you know, phylogenetic analysis and typing analysis as a prerequisite before you start to analyze anything and everything with respect to viruses. Now, when one wants to carry out phylogenetic analysis, or you want to use phylogenetic analysis for typing of viruses, you know, as I have already mentioned, ICTV study groups guide you, and they have come up with this, you know, guidelines, very broad guidelines for typing of viruses. Of course, you have experimental methods in virology, you know, as one of the primary approach for typing. But in addition to immunological methods, in addition to virological methods for experimental typing, ICTV subscribes to and endorses computational methods for virus typing. And these computational methods are divided broadly into two categories, that they are alignment-based or alignment-free. Now, these alignment-based and alignment-free group of methods we are going to study in detail. And one can use you know, either the individual gene or genomic regions or the whole genomes for the phylogeny and typing of these viruses. So this is the broad spectrum or the category in which you know, these methods are divided. Now, before we again get into the typing or classification of viruses, let me just introduce you to some of the fundamental concepts in phylogenetic generating and analyzing phylogenetic trees. So what you see here is a 2D graph. So this is a phylogenetic tree, a representative one, where you see, you know, different OTUs, okay? So basically phylogenetic tree is a 2D graph where you see bifurcating tree topologies, and you analyze these bifurcating tree topologies in order to make sense of evolutionary relatedness of the isolates or the species that are used for analysis. So phylogenetic tree is a 2D graph that illustrates evolutionary relationship using nodes and branches. So typically A, B, C, D, E, H, F, and G are referred to as nodes, and these are the branches that lead to the nodes. So these nodes represent OTUs or operational taxonomic units. These are the entities that you want to cluster. These are the entities you want to study the evolutionary, you know, bifurcation. Then these OTUs are linked with branches. So for example, C and D, okay, you have these two branches. One goes to C and D, and there is this intermediate or internal node H, which is called as, you know, evolutionary ancestor. Okay, so these are the operational taxonomic unit, the species that you are interested in clustering, and these are their immediate evolutionary ancestor. I'm sorry, a line that connects from F to B is missing here. Now you see this as branches of variable length, okay? So a tree topology is a branching pattern, a picture that
you see as a 2D graph, and branch length represent number of changes that might have occurred along the branch. Okay, so you have some branch have shorter length as compared to some other branch. So the lengths are usually proportional to the changes. And then I have already told you that internal nodes are common ancestor, and you may have trees drawn where you have scaled branches, that is the length proportional to number of changes. And you may have trees such that, they have unscaled branches or uniform length. Now, based on, the tree topology that you have and the underlying evolutionary relationship, usually tags are sort of indicated using very, very specific terms such as monophyletic taxa. Okay, so when you have two OTUs that are derived from a common ancestor, for example, C and D here, okay? So they are monophyletic, that is, they have a mono or single origin, they share a common ancestor. Polyphyletic taxa, on the other hand, refers to, many OTUs or many operational taxonomic units which share multiple common ancestors. Like, for example, you can discuss the bifurcating tree topology of C, D, and E. They are sort of polyphyletic. And then you have paraphyletic taxa, where you have OTUs derived from a common ancestor, but the group does not include all the descendant taxa that have derived from a common ancestor. So when you are describing the bifurcating tree topology with respect to a select species such as A, C, D, and E, then you say that they have paraphyletic origin. And then clad refers to usually a monophyletic group that include all descendant species from an evolutionary ancestor. By the way, this particular tree has a root. So this is a rooted tree. But most often than not, what we see as unrooted tree, because we may not have the information with respect to the origin of our ancestor for all the descendant taxa. In that case, we can just draw an unrooted tree, which provides relative evolution or branching tree topologies, and you can make certain observations and interpretations based on that. At any point of time, you can root an unrooted tree, okay? So most often than not, you derive an unrooted tree, but if you know a species that has branched off prior to, all other species that you are trying to analyze, then you can, at any point of time, root an unrooted tree. So these are some of the, basics or fundamentals. So on the left-hand side of this slide, I have tried to sort of explain different terminologies that are often used with respect to phylogenetic trees. So you have cladogram versus phylogram. So cladograms, when you read in the research paper, let us say that figure one describes a cladogram, it means that there the branch lengths are uniform, okay? And they only represent relationship. Whereas when somebody is referring to a phylogenetic tree or a phylogram, that means the lengths of the branches are proportional to the changes or the distance between the operational taxonomic units. As I have explained to you, trees can be rooted or unrooted, but most trees are unrooted. And then there are artistic trees, and when we will show you a demo, you will see, Manjari would show you, different representations such as rectangular versus circular and so on and so forth. Another very, very fundamental and important concept in the field of phylogenetics is the species tree, okay? So the species tree represent evolutionary relationship of a group of species or group of organisms as compared to, there can be a gene tree. So gene tree can be constructed using a single gene or a group of genes or a genomic region. So please understand that gene tree can differ from species tree in two fundamental ways. divergence of two genes, sampled by the species may predate the divergence of species themselves. And therefore, the branching pattern of the topology may be different from that of the species tree. Gene tree may or may not coincide with species tree. And the classical example is, if you're trying to generate a tree using, let us say, the paralogs, we'll be talking about what orthologs and paralogs are. Again, they are something, some fundamental concept before we dive deep into systematics and phylogeny. All right. So where do you typically use phylogenetic analysis? Let us say that, you have a virus circulating in a population. Every year in the rainy season, we have surge of dengue viruses, for example. And you want to quickly characterize what are the genotypes or what kind of dengue viruses are circulating. Or with respect to the current SARS-CoV-2 pandemic, when you want to understand how and which kind of lineages are circulating in, let us say, Maharashtra versus West Bengal versus Karnataka or Telangana or Kerala, you need to sort of obtain the genomic sequence and subject the genomic sequences of these isolates for the phylogenetic analysis. So usually you begin the phylogenetic analysis with a definite objective, and that objective is can be you want to carry out genetic epidemiology or you want to see if there are any emergence of new lineages or are there any drug resistant lineage. It could be anything. So you start with a question usually, then you curate a set of reference sequences. What are these? These are known types. Okay, in dengue viruses you have four serotypes, let us say dengue 1, 2, 3, 4, and each serotype has genotypes. So you will curate the data of serotypes and respective genotypes, and you would sort of compile a reference data set, okay? So which has representation of all known types of that particular virus. And then you will carry out something called as multiple sequence alignment. Multiple sequence alignment output is typically, input for the phylogenetic analysis program. Again, you can use multiple methods for phylogenetic analysis, such as distance-based, character-based, or Bayesian-based methods. And then using one of these methods or multiple methods or all of these methods, you come up with the tree. So every tree tells you a story of evolution. And then but an important point of consideration in phylogenetic analysis is, what is my confidence on bifurcating tree topology? And that confidence that can be or is generated using a technique called as bootstrapping, where you sort of simulate or randomize the data sets and then derive multiple trees. And then you try to look, let us say for species A, clusters with species C, and you have 100 bootstrap samples, you would have generated 100 base trees. So out of these 100 base trees, in how many trees you see A and C paired together? And if that answer is more than 75, that is 80% times A paired with C or A clustered with C, you have reasonable confidence. What does that mean? That A and C clustered together 80 times, but 20 times in 20 trees, A and C respectively clustered with some other OTUs. Okay, so that's the statistical technique called as bootstrapping, which gives you confidence levels before you interpret the trees. Then you generate, consensus tree, assess the tree topology, and most important part of phylogenetic analysis actually is interpretation of the trees that you have generated. Now, before we get into the methods for phylogenetic analysis,
ma'am, yeah? They want to understand bootstrapping concept again. In the chat, they put. Yeah.
Okay. My screen was full screen, so I couldn't see the chat. All right. So, you know, we will be discussing bootstrapping. So, okay. All right. You start with a biological, you know, sample or a data set, right? Let us say that you have reference data containing, you know, 25, you know, representation of 25 isolates. And then with this reference 25 isolates, you have in addition to 25, you have certain field isolates sampled from patients, and they are, let us say, 10 isolates. So 25 plus 10, 35 isolates you are trying to analyze using phylogenetic tree. All right. So so when you use one of the methods to generate the phylogeny, okay, you will come up with a tree topology that I described before. But what is a phylogenetic tree and a tree topology? It tells you clustering proximity of different isolates or OTUs. So let us say isolate A and C, okay, they are clustering together. But what is your confidence that A and C are indeed related, okay? And they are not there just due to the random chance or you know, similarity that exists in the sequences. So you want to sort of assess the statistical confidence of resultant tree topologies. So how do you generate that? You need to generate, let us say, randomized data set. So your original biological data set is 35 sequences, 35 OTUs, 35 isolates. These 35 isolates, data of 35 isolates can be used to generate 100 randomized samples. There are different ways of randomization. We'll not get into that. But for every true biological sample, you can have 100 different randomized samples. So just like you would generate a phylogenetic tree, let us say using a character-based method for your original data set, you would also generate trees, 100 different trees using each of the randomized data set. And then you are generating the consensus tree and you are trying to count out of 101 trees that you have generated, okay, 100 trees that you have generated from the random sample and one from the real sample, how many times indeed, you know, the isolate A clustered with isolate C or isolate B clustered with isolate E, let us say. Okay, you are just going to count from each of these 100 trees that are generated from simulated data. And if your count of A clustering with C is greater than 75, then you have very high confidence that indeed A and C cluster together and they are evolutionarily related. So that's the concept of bootstrapping, or that's the concept of randomization. And again, when we will show you the demo, we will actually show you how these random data sets are generated and how do you label the trees with the bootstrap data. Is this clear to you now? Can we go ahead, Manjari?
Yes, ma'am.
You have the participants?
Yeah, they have.
They can just unmute the mic and ask questions.
Anshu has raised it and she told that she has understood that.
Thank you, ma'am. It's clear.
Okay, all right. So let's now move on to actually the methods for the phylogenetic analysis. And I told you that there are two main categories of methods, alignment based and alignment free. Now alignment based method themselves, are divided into three broad categories, like distance based, character based and Bayesian based methods. All right, so what is it that phylogenetic analysis is allowing us to do? It is allowing us to measure or to look at the similarities within the group and differences between the group. And that forms the fundamental basis on the which we get these bifurcating tree topologies. Now, these methods are part of sequence-based bioinformatics approaches, and you know, there are applications like you can study evolution of genes, evolution of species, you can assign a species in the taxonomic hierarchy, you can predict or assign genotype or serotype for different isolates, and you can also study novel properties like drug resistance. So due to paucity of time, we may not be able to go into each of these applications, but you can explore them later. Again, now understanding of phylogenetics requires understanding with respect to some fundamental aspect of sequence alignment. And this is what Prash had specifically told us, that if we could touch upon these fundamentals, it would be great, because some of you haven't yet formally explored the field of bioinformatics. So alignment, you are trying to compare or align the sequences, okay? So alignment, there are three major algorithms. You have pairwise, wherein you align two sequences, as the name indicates. So pairwise global, that is you align pairwise sequences end to end. Pairwise local, that is you look for regions of local similarity. Or you need to, when you have three or more sequences, then you need to carry out alignment of multiple sequences, and hence the name multiple sequence alignment. So whenever you are aligning, I will show you on a set of sequences and algorithms, but another set of important concepts are identity, similarity, and insertion deletions, which I will explain you with an example. And you use these alignments to infer evolutionary relationship. And if two proteins or two genes, they share an evolutionary ancestor, we say that they are homologous to each other. And what that homology is, I will explain to you. Now, this is a super busy, super condensed slide, but here it goes. So you have this representative sequence one, and another representative, now these are edited for demo purposes, protein sequences. Now a visual comparison between these two sequences, you understand that there are certain amino acids which are exactly identical between the two, all right? And you don't need any fancy algorithm to align the sequences. You can just go on writing the identical characters one below the other, and you come up with this one linear alignment, okay? But as a biologist, you are not happy with this linear alignment, because you know that there are some identities and similarities towards the C-terminal of these two protein sequences. And for that, you can just play a trick. You can slide the second sequence by just one position, and then you are able to capture the identities towards the center and towards the end. But again, the biologist in you is not very happy. Say none of these two linear alignments are actually optimal, and you are trying to optimize these two alignments, and you say optimal alignment can be generated, and it becomes an optimization problem wherein you are trying to maximize on sequence identities, and while achieving that, you are minimizing on number of breaks that can be inserted. So now this second sequence has this dash symbol. It is called as break, okay? It is a deletion. It is interpreted as a deletion in this sequence. So deletion in one sequence can be interpreted as insertion in the other sequence. So you are able to capture all identities just by inserting one gap. Now, how many gaps are to be inserted? Where the gaps are to be inserted? There is a mathematical formulation to this algorithm, and there are these two major algorithms in the field of bioinformatics. The global alignment algorithm aligns the sequences from one end to other, as the name indicates, whereas local alignment algorithm tries to identify regions of local similarities between the sequences. Okay, and how it does that? Again, there is this optimization functions that I have tried to written here. It is a dynamic programming algorithm where you try to sort of score the identities and similarities between the sequences in a recursive manner. The algorithm is called as Needleman and Wunsch for global alignment, and Smith and Waterman for the local alignment. Now, these algorithms are very sort of exhaustive, and they are sort of they require a few hours of explanation if one really wants to understand. But the take-home message that I'm trying to drive here is that you have certain algorithms which will help you to align the sequences in an optimal or the best possible solution. Now, when the alignment algorithm gives you this kind of alignment, you can identify how many positions you have same amino acid, how many positions there are mutations or change in amino acid, and how many positions there are breaks or gaps. Now, mind you, these gaps or breaks are not physical in that particular sequence, but the alignment algorithm helps us to simulate what might have happened in the process of evolution and to depict such incidents or events in the process of evolution. It is showing it as a gap. So gap in one sequence is interpreted as insertion in other sequence, because we do not often know the evolutionary histories of the sequences that we are trying to analyze. So again, these algorithms, you can see that there are some score, you build the matrix, then you walk the path in the two-dimensional matrix, and wherever you deviate from the diagonal path, like here, horizontal, wherever you deviate from the path, that leads to insertion of break. This is a very, very simplified explanation of the alignment, pairwise alignment algorithms that I'm telling you. So global alignment offer you a solution to identify similarities across the entire length. So N-terminal to C-terminal in case of proteins, and 5' end to 3' end in case of nucleotides. But sequences may not share overall similarity and can have some subdomains that are similar between them. Okay, and local alignment algorithms, Smith and Waterman, would help you to identify such local regions of similarity between the two sequences, and again will return output in terms of identity, similarity, and number of gaps inserted. So you can see in this particular matrix, there are multiple paths, and each of these paths lead to one or the other alignment. I hope this gives you a broad perspective with respect to alignment. So another very, very popular local alignment algorithm in the field of bioinformatics is BLAST, where you use sequence as a query. Okay, you use a protein or nucleotide sequence as a query, and you ask the question, how many sequences are there in the database which are quote unquote similar to the sequence that I have at hand? Okay, and this is a very, very popular algorithm which actually converts your input or a query sequence into overlapping words, and use the dictionary of words to match with the several hundred thousand sequences that are present in the database, uses some kind of scoring and ranking to fetch, high scoring words. And using these high scoring words, you arrive at, the local alignment. So just imagine you use Needleman and Wunsch or Smith-Waterman pairwise alignment algorithm to compare sequence of your interest, a novel sequence, with several hundred thousand sequences in the database. You would just waste a lot of time. So at that point of time, you are okay to apply a heuristic solution like BLAST, okay, and to fetch out certain entries or some simple, or approximation, and then the list of hits that you get, you are free to analyze them in detail. So this is BLAST, which helps you to fetch the sequences in one go. Just excuse me. All right, then we are done with fundamentals of pairwise alignment, and then with the BLAST. Then actually what you need for phylogenetic analysis is multiple sequence alignment. You're trying to align three or more sequences. So how exactly this is done? Now, let's say you have four sequences. So basically, how many pair combinations you will have? 4 × 3 divided by 2. Okay, you will have those many pairwise comparison. So every sequence is aligned with every other sequence in pairwise fashion. Okay, and then you you get some kind of alignment score for every pair. Use that score for clustering the sequences to get the order or the maximally similar pairs. And then you arrive at such a clustering pattern that sequence one is very similar to three and sequence two is similar to four. You get this kind of dendrogram, and then that dendrogram is used to align the most similar pair first, to which, you know, the next most similar pair is aligned, and the alignment of alignments is carried out to get the multiple sequence alignment. Again, these are very, very simplified representation. All right. Now, a typical MSA looks like this, what I have shown you in the center. You have several sequences and you consider a column in the multiple sequence alignment. In this particular column, all A's are present, and that is why this column is marked with star. So it indicates exact identity. Then if you look at this particular column, then it has one E and all other A's. So there is a colon. That means there is a substitution, a favorable substitution. And then there is a dot where, you know, these amino acid replacements, okay, are again favored replacements. So E is glutamic acid and D is aspartic acid. So they are indicated with, you know, a dot. So multiple sequence alignment would give you a picture like this. Unfortunately, in this small snapshot, there is no insertion or deletion shown. But how similar is similar and how different is different is one of the fundamental questions that is usually asked and explored. Now, how similar is similar depends on what is the purpose for which you are aligning. Now, I have pinned here the evolutionary biologists because we are trying to use these alignments for the purpose of generating the phylogenetic tree or for typing of viruses. Typically, for a biochemist, you know, you look for identities in the active site, binding sites, and overall, you know, identity and similarities. For a, if you are a modeler, then, you know, 35% of identity and similarity is good enough to build a good quality homology model, you are happy. Drug designer, you know, again, would look for higher similarity in the pockets and so on and so forth. But an immunologist has a very different perspective. Immunologists may not be satisfied even with 95% of identity and similarity, because those 5% differences are huge in terms of, let us say, you human hemoglobin and chimpanzee hemoglobin. There is difference of only 4 or 5%. But if you, you know, extract chimpanzee hemoglobin and inject into human or vice versa, you know, both these hosts would mount the immune response. They would recognize these hemoglobin molecules as non-self. That means for an immunologist, greater than 95 or 96% of identity and similarity is also it's also not good, or there are exclamatory marks. So how similar is similar and how different depends on the question you want to answer using the alignment output. So with this understanding, now let us move on to some of the distance-based methods. So in order to use the distance-based methods for phylogenetic analysis, your prerequisite is to calculate the distance. And the simplest distance that can be calculated is just the percentage. Again, I have shown you a small snapshot. A small snapshot where, you know, you have three sequences. These two sequences, you know, have mutations at two locations. Rest of the eight positions are exactly identical. So you have percent similarity 80% between sequence 1 and 2, and that leads to the distance of 0.2. So 20% distance, which is scaled between 0 and 1. Okay, so every sequence is exactly identical with itself, so the distance matrix will have a value of 0. But sequence S1 with S2, just now what we have seen, 0.2 is the distance. And then you have between S1 and S3, four sites are different, so it leads to distance of 0.4. So here, what has been shown is a lower triangle of the distance matrix, which goes typically as an input to the distance-based algorithm like UPGMA, which is a very, very simple algorithm. And then you have neighbor joining method. Okay, this is another method wherein you start with alignment-based and distance-based method. You start with a star-like topology that you have a central ancestral node from which all other sequences are at equidistance. And then you go on finding the neighbors sequentially that minimize the total length of the tree. So this tree is optimized such that you are minimizing on the length of the tree. Okay, so if sequence 1 and 2 are highly similar, then you separate them, you draw a common ancestor X here, and then X is linked with the centroid Y, and then you find out the next similar pair. But while doing this exercise, there are n number of possibilities, right? There are large number of tree topologies that can be generated. So which ones would you retain and which ones would you discard? You would take that call based on the optimization function that, you know, you would say that the tree that can be obtained such that it has minimum total length for the tree. Okay, branch length is minimal. That's the best tree. And that is the simple. So you are going sequentially going on joining the neighbors, and that is why this particular method is called as a neighbor joining method. So I'm just giving you very, very brief conceptual overview of individual methods. Now from distance-based method, let us move on to the character-based methods, where, you know, again, you start with multiple sequence alignment. And so let us first look at from the phylogeny perspective, you know, how do you interpret the information content of multiple sequence alignment? So I had shown you a site which has same character is denoted with star, exact identity between the set of sequences. But this information is very good from the perspective of homology or from the perspective of identifying, you know, patterns and motifs. But such a site proves to be less informative in terms of phylogenetic analysis. It is an invariant site. So in phylogeny, we want to look at the distances between the set of sequences. And therefore, we are trying to look at informative sites. Now, you know, there could be sites where you have three G's and one A. So it is an uninformative site. It's a singleton site. Only one sequence has this mutation. Whereas look at this particular site where there are two G's and two A's. So this is an informative variable site. Using this site, you can categorize or cluster these four sequences into two clusters, wherein sequence 1 and 2 belong to one cluster and sequence 3 and 4 belong to other cluster. So this is how typically you use the multiple sequence alignment and process the information content to derive the tree topology. So now how exactly it is done, I will show you. These methods are called as parsimony methods. They are originally developed for protein sequences. Here the principle is to identify the tree topology that requires smallest number of evolutionary changes or substitution to explain the differences between the OTUs. Okay, so this is getting onto the jargon, but let us look at this particular example wherein, you know, three possible unrooted tree topologies are shown using different sites in the previous multiple sequence alignment. For example, I will explain this using one or two examples. Let us say if you take site 3, okay? So this is the site 3 where you have G, C, A, and A. Now remember this, okay? Sequence 1 had G, sequence 2 had C, sequence 3 had A, and 4 also had A. Now, if sequence 1 and 2 cluster together, then the ancestral sequence can have G at this position. So there is one change along this branch, which is indicated with this dot. So G changes to C. And A, it is exact identity. So ancestral sequence would have had A at this position. So again, between these two cluster, there is one mutation which is indicated with dot. And then like for every site, you derive, you know, at least three topologies as shown in this. So this same site three can be used to derive this particular tree topology, where one and three cluster together and two and four cluster together. Again, this clustering pattern can be explained using two mutations from the ancestral sequence to present day sequences. And then there could be a third tree topology where we are telling the story that one and four is closely related and two and three are closely related, and their immediate evolutionary ancestor and the changes along the branches can be explained with two mutations. So what does it mean? This is my version of the story of evolution, right? Every tree topology is a version. Okay, out of these many versions, which version is the best or the optimum one? That is decided using the bootstrap data analysis that I explained to you. And the main principle of parsimony or the character-based method can be explained using this tree topology. Okay, here site four, you are shown, you know, changes with three dots in this topology, three mutation or changes in this tree topology, and four dots or changes with this four topology. So if you consider the information content of site four, then this is definitely disregarded because this is not minimum. Here, four changes are there. You need to explain the tree topology using four changes, which is not optimal, and therefore you are discarding this. But whereas you look at the site five, which offers you information content such as only with one change or one dot, you are able to explain that sequence one and two are closely related and three and four are closely related. Okay, so that's the case which I explained. So these type of varying tree topologies are generated using character-based methods before the methods return us the best possible tree. After the distance-based method, character-based method, another very, very popular group of methods are Bayesian-based methods or likelihood-based methods. Now, these likelihood-based methods, okay, here you are computing likelihood or the probability of data given tree, and you optimize such that you find a tree amongst the many trees that are possible, the tree which has highest likelihood value, where you can explain the tree topology using the existing data. And today we plan to show you a demo of ML method using IQ Tree software. So you will be able to appreciate what this maximum likelihood method, you know, how it works. So we have seen this workflow. What I have added here is that you started with 25 reference sequences and 10 lab isolates or field isolates. So you want to assign now genotypes, serotypes, or whatever to these 10 isolates. You have to interpret the data based on the clustering proximity of unknown with the known. Okay, and that is how you assign that. And we will see it using at least one or two examples. All right. Now this is where I'm concluding the phylogenetic analysis, alignment-based analysis. What are the caveats? Caveats are, you know, heuristic appeal in the sequence alignment algorithms. Positions of indels may differ using different scoring matrices, different algorithms, and therefore your phylogenetic model could get affected. Then the character-based methods, they assume that sites evolve independently, but analysis of 3D structure data tells us that there are co-evolving sites and so on and so forth. So there are certain limitations of the caveats. You need to understand them. Sometimes, you know, character-based methods, it becomes extremely difficult to analyze the genomic data using these methods because the size of genomes are huge, and then these methods crash. And the most important bottleneck of all of the above is that you want to type an additional isolate, you have to carry out MSA again, you have to build the phylogenetic model again, you need to interpret the tree again. So you need to repeat the task with just one isolate, additional isolate at hand. And that is where people started thinking about, can we come up with or can we design,
just a minute. Battery is an issue. Just a minute, huh? Please give me a second. I'm sorry for that. All right. So that's when, people started thinking about, can we develop alignment-free methods, and especially they are required in the field of microbial or viral typing. So, in our lab, we designed a novel alignment-free approach for typing and phylogeny of viruses based on the concept of return time distribution. Now, return times, return times are, I will explain you in a while, but basically these methods work with the frequency of k-mers and their return times in order to generate the clustering pattern for viral phylogeny and typing. So these methods we have tested, they work equally well at varying levels of sequence similarity from, let's say, 30% to 99%, and they are fast, accurate, and highly sensitive methods. Again, let me just take a break to switch the light on. Sorry. So let us say that you have this genomic sequence, okay, again a representative in which I am showing you computation of return time distribution for a character A, which is a word of size 1, just 1. All right, so here, what is return time? It's a time required for reappearance of a state without its appearance in between. Okay, so let us look at with this example. So A reappears after a gap of one character, that is C, therefore the return time of 1 is written here. Okay, again, between this A and this A, there is a gap of one character, so return time of 1. But this A succeeds immediately, there is no gap in between, so return time is 0. When there are 10 characters in between, you say that return time is 10, so on and so forth. So what we are trying to do here, we are converting the character string data into a numeric vector of return times. Okay, and this k can be varied. K can be 2, 3, 4, and so on and so forth. And we compute simply the frequency of return times. So return time of 0 was sampled 5 times. Return time of 1 was sampled 4 times, and so on and so forth. And we calculate simple mean and standard deviation for the return time of A. And similarly, you can compute return time for other characters at k equal to 1, T, G, and C. Similarly, k equal to 2, you will have 16 return times. K equal to 3, you will have 64 return times. All right. Once we have the return time and the return time distribution, we convert it into distance matrix, and for that purpose, we use simple Euclidean distance formula that is shown here. So you read the sequences, process using Perl script, derive a distance matrix, then use a Euclidean distance function to compute the distances, use neighbor joining method, distance-based method for deriving the tree, and you have the tree. The same thing is written, shown in two different representations here. So this is basically the gist of our algorithm. And we tested this algorithm using the members of family Flaviviridae, wherein sequence identity varies between 40 to 86%. So flavivirus, some of the members are dengue, Japanese encephalitis, West Nile virus, yellow fever virus, so on and so forth.
Flaviviridae contains four genera: flavivirus, hepasivirus, pegivirus, and pestivirus. And you can see beautifully these viruses, they cluster with in accordance with their taxonomical hierarchical pattern. And that is where we sort of validated that this method for alignment free clustering works, and we have a server that is available at our cloud platform, and then we are going to show you a demo. All right, we could substantially save time and eliminate the step of getting multiple sequence alignment done again and again. But that did not solve our problem of typing of viruses, because then whether alignment best or alignment free method, we were required to generate the tree topology, and then finally it was human intervention and manual interpretation of the tree that led us to assignment of genotype or serotype. And then there we started thinking, can we develop some kind of a wrapper around this RTD based phylogeny, which can automate this step of assignment of serotype or genotype. So this is a flow chart wherein I have summarized all methods for viral typing. So you start with sequence data set, you have alignment based or alignment free. So alignment based method we have seen, where you start with multiple sequence alignment, you use any of the character-based or distance-based method, and then you arrive at a phylogenetic tree in this fashion. To that, we added this vertical of alignment-free phylogeny, and then phylogenetic tree was generated, which was required to be interpreted for assignment of the serotype or genotype. And that is where this knowledge-based wrappers were developed, which were customized and unique to every virus. And that can convert this, our basic algorithm of RTD, into a dedicated server for individual virus. And this wrapper is shown here. So again, in the background, we have the same algorithm. And this wrapper is, you curate the customized data for a particular virus, you optimize the k at which you are getting the clusters that match the RTD based taxonomic recommendations, and then you compute the distances between the genotypes, serotypes or lineages, and you compute the sensitivity specificity, optimize this through several rounds, and once it is optimized, it should give you the assignment of genotype. So I would now like to present a brief case study wherein we applied it to the mumps virus. Mumps, as is a virus that belongs to family Paramyxoviridae. It is responsible for most common childhood infection, where you see the swelling of the parotid glands, so it's an important, and then mumps is part of MMR vaccine, and every child is immunized with MMR vaccine. Some late incidence of mumps infections are also seen in adults, and it is quite difficult when adults get reinfected with mumps. And then there is this resurgence and revisit of mumps epidemics, demanded that, you need to validate, vaccines. There were monodi and trivalent vaccines available. But, even if one is vaccinated, based on the different genotypes that circulate within the population, there could always be some escape from the neutralization, and that would result in mumps infection. And the need for genotyping is, you need to estimate the vaccine accuracy. WHO recommends molecular epidemiology for the mumps virus. There are national surveillance programs, and you need to find out, the virus that circulates locally within the geographic location. And then people used to, use alignment-based methods and repetitive analysis. I told you, mumps at a glance, it's a small virus with a small genome. It is one single fragment. And then there is this small SH small hydrophobic protein or a gene corresponding to this protein, which is responsible for or which is used for typing. And there are 12 known genotypes when we developed the server. Subsequently, ICTV and the virologist has revised the genotypes. Two genotypes are merged and N as a new genotype has been floated. So we have to also revise our server in light of these revisions, but which is a doable job, and we have done that. These genotypes, as I mentioned to you, we curated reference data sets from A to L, including M, and then, you know, multiple sequence alignment, phylogenetic analysis. We used all sorts of methods to establish the comparison. As I explained to you, we developed this wrapper. We tested it using, you know, this is the reference data set, test one, test two, test three data sets. And then we realized that the server, you know, when we clustered using K equal to 4 using RTD, we got this type of clustering, very clean clustering for reference data, and equally clean clustering for test data set one and two, of which the result of two are shown here. And that gave us confidence that we can use K-mer size of 4 to develop the server for typing. And we wanted to publish it, but benchmark or the standard was BLAST-based typing or the classical alignment-based typing. So our server has all the three methods implemented. You need to provide SH gene sequence as an input, and you can either go for BLAST-based typing or phylogeny-based typing. There is a phylogenetic analysis program, PhylicWorks, at the back end, as well as you have the novel method of return time distribution-based typing, and we are going to show a demo of this. So this is where we documented this story. The sensitivity was 98.95% and specificity 100%. This made us go back to the data set of test data set 3, and we realized that it was not the error with the program, but the annotation error in the data that was deposited in GenBank. So all our RTD-based server have 100% sensitivity and specificity. Unless we reach 100% sensitivity and specificity, we are not releasing these servers in the public domain. So we started with SH, which is a very small fragment, 317 nucleotide. And then we expanded this method for whole genome-based typing for dengue and West Nile subtyper. And then we also dabbled with, you know, if we can use protein-based RTD for human rhinoviruses, which are common cold viruses. And we also use this protein-based RTD approach to identify the drug resistance in rhinoviruses, where picornaril is a drug. And we tried to use protein sequence-based RTD for dengue host specificity, you know, the urban versus sylvatic lineages. And currently, we are trying to expand it to microbial taxonomy using multilocus. All right, so these are the snapshots of the server that we have developed so far. And you can use any of these servers for typing. We get a lot of people have been using these servers. So, you know, this is the story about, you know, what we have been doing at Bioinformatics Center with respect to, you know, genotyping or serotyping, but we are not the only one. There is this, dengue virus typing tool, which we are going to show you a demo of at Genome Detective. So you have Genome Detective has been developed by, you know, Oliveira's group in South Africa. And that Genome Detective, there is one version which can be used freely in public domain, and it contains, you know, different typers for chikungunya, coronavirus, dengue, HCV, and so on and so forth, wherein you can type limited set of sequences. But if you want to go for, you know, unlimited typing, then I think commercial version exists. And this is a snapshot that I have tried to show you, where their dengue virus typer tool, which we have identified for today's demo, wherein, you know, they are using maximum likelihood based phylogeny at the back end for typing of dengue viruses, which have the genome of 10K plus nucleotides. So this is the typer. So typing, there are other typers available where, you know, blast-based typing is also done, but we have just chosen this representative. All right. But virus bioinformatics is not just typing. It is not limited to assignment of genome serotypes or lineages. You want to correlate these differences in the genome to the structure and function. Because viruses being very simple, you know, it is possible to correlate genomic variation with protein variation, the variation it may cause in terms of structure and function. And again, I will just take a few minutes where I will explain using the MERS virus. This was a query from Serum Institute of India. And with respect to their MMR vaccine, where they had reported that a circulating lineage in Europe, in UK in particular, was escaping neutralization using their MMR vaccine. And this was a project we did way back in 2006 and 7, but is a beautiful example of correlation of genomic variation with the function and translation. So you know, we started with a set of sequences for the vaccine isolate, set of sequences for wild type genotypes, and analyzed them, did same multiple sequence and pairwise sequence alignment that I talked about. And for the hemagglutinin neuraminidase, the protein on the surface of the virus, which is the major antigenic protein for the MERS virus, we predicted three-dimensional structure for the hemagglutinin neuraminidase. And that ribbon diagram is shown here. And this is a surface representation of dimer from one of the, you know, MERS isolate, which is a type that is used for development of vaccine by Serum, the El Zagreb one. And what we have done, 3D structure using homology modeling, multiple sequence alignment was used to identify the sites under selection. We colored and shown these sites under selection on the surface. And to our surprise, out of 24 mutations, you know, side one included 16, side two included 8. All of these mutations were present on surface. Just one was buried at the interface area. So basically, dimer interface is free of mutations. And these mutations, they appear to be sequentially apart, okay? If you map them in terms of sequence, but the 3D structure mapping brought them into the proximity. They are specially localized. And using this particular observation, we could sort of predict that this could be a major neutralizing conformational epitope. And any variation in this conformational epitope leads to escape. And that is how we helped Serum. Initially, they were reluctant to publish it and it was total proprietary, but later they said that they would like to have this study published, and that is how we have a publication wherein Sunita Manjari used to then work as an associate with me, and she is an author on this paper with a few other students. So, you know, same sequence analysis, structure analysis, correlating genome to structure and function could help us explain the limiting accuracy of vaccine. Here, the major change is N464 with K. So N, this particular ASN was interesting because it was a glycosylation site. And this glycosylation site was lost in these vaccine strains. And we know that, you know, the protein interface would be seen by immune system in totally different way in the presence and absence of carbohydrate moiety, and that is how we could explain. We don't have time to get into the details of this particular study, but here the rule of majority has been used for coloring. So wherever you see identical amino acid in three isolate, this is wild type isolate and these three are vaccine isolate. So if same residue is present, then it is colored in dark color. Wherever there is a mutation with respect to that residue, it has been shown in the light color, and it holds good for this coloring. So we have explained this story in detail in the paper, and you can use. So this gave us, in fact, an insight that we need a server for quick typing of viruses to identify the efficacy. So this Serum project proved to be a genesis for development of that server. And towards the end, I would like to acknowledge generous funding from DBT, MCIT, you know, our group is funded with Indo-Norwegian program, in addition to certain institutional, you know, funding. Blessed with the collaborators, longtime friend and collaborator Dr. Mohan Kale from Statistics Department, have a few collaborators from NARI, wherein we are working on different viruses. And then, you know, collaborators from my, so all the names in the blue are the ones who have been sort of associated with the studies that I presented today, and also blessed to have wonderful, you know, PhD and master students. Pandurang Kolekar developed this method for RTD and the servers. Vaishali helped me explain, I expand the domain to population genomics, which Manjari is adding new facets to, which I plan to talk tomorrow. Mukund Ram Tirthakar is Dr. Mohan Kale's PhD student and is very closely associated. Sanket and Minil Kinikar are helping with respect to some of the other virus data analysis, HPV in particular. And then, you know, Anand, Nilesh, Hemant, and Madhura are the master students who have contributed significantly to development of one or the other typing servers, and they are authors on our publication. And with this, I think I would like to stop here and take questions if you have any. And this could have been overwhelming. You know, we had a lot planned on agenda for you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Kale and Dr. Sunita. Now I request participants, especially the students, and then to ask questions, no, post questions, if any. Yeah. Yeah, there must be some doubts.
Hopefully. you know, it's...
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
Thank you for such a nice presentation. And there was some terminology in your slide while stating about the terms of that phylogenetic tree, something called orthologs, paralogs. Can you please explain me those terms in a very simple manner?
Sure, I'll try to, okay? So you use a sequence comparison in order to make assessment about evolutionary relatedness of the genes, proteins, or the organisms, okay? So when you have two proteins which share a common ancestor, okay, they are called homologs. So homology indicates evolutionary relationship. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So hemoglobin alpha chain and hemoglobin beta chain, okay? They are homologs, right?
Okay.
They evolved from a common ancestor. But these homologs can be classified into two types or three types. So when you talk about evolutionarily related, you know, proteins or gene sequences from different species, that means hemoglobin alpha from human and hemoglobin alpha from horse, they are referred to as orthologs of each other's.
Okay.
Same gene, same protein in two different species. All right?
Yes, ma'am.
They are orthologs. Sometimes evolution take, so these orthologs are product of speciation. You agree, right?
Yes.
Sometimes what happens, prior to speciation, gene duplication event takes place. Okay, so hemoglobin alpha in human would be duplicated. Okay, two copies would be made, right? And one copy continues to carry out previous function. Nature uses second copy to modify the function, okay? And these two, that is the gene which arise from a common ancestor and present in the same organism are called as paralogs.
But they will be performing different functions, right?
Related functions, not entirely different functions.
Okay. Okay.
So hemoglobin alpha in human, hemoglobin beta in human, they are paralogs, delta, epsilon. There are many chains like that, right?
Okay.
So they are paralogs. So here, before the species diverges into two daughter species, duplication event takes place, and that duplication event is responsible for the rise of paralogs.
Okay.
Clear?
Okay.
Okay. Yes. So xenolog is a third case of homologs, wherein you know you have the evolutionary related sequences due to horizontal transfer. So co-infecting organisms may acquire the genetic material either from host or vice versa, and then both of them would have that gene or that protein, and then they are referred to as xenologs.
It was not clear to me. Okay. The xenologs.
So let us say a parasite infects a plant or an animal. Okay, the parasite is within the plant or in the animal. Both of them are co-evolving. Okay, the gene from the parasite gets inserted into human or vice versa. Okay.
Okay.
And these two, a gene or a protein from the parasite and gene or protein from the host, okay, are referred to as xenolog, that either of them have received it due to the horizontal gene transfer.
Okay, now I can understand.
Okay, all right. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Wonderfully inserted, ma'am. It was a wonderful presentation, actually. I mean, very, very, very crisp, very clear. Friends, I think, we should give a thumping round of applause to ma'am. So please unmute your microphone and give her a big round of applause.
It was quite an ambitious plan. It took over so many aspects of, phylogenetic analysis.
No, wonderful, ma'am. I mean, it was always nice hearing you. I mean, we learned a lot of new things every time. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you.
So friends, ma'am is still there. She's also there tomorrow as well. So do you have any quick questions before we move to Sunita?
And I'm going to be there till the end of the workshop today with Sunita. So we can back and forth discuss today and tomorrow both.
Thank you.
So the way